Hello and welcome. Thank you so much for joining me. It is great to have everyone here today. And I see a lot of friends in the chat. And so welcome to Johnny, Sandy, Skitzcrasher. And let's see, that's all I'm seeing at the moment. And welcome to Dan, a new friend. It's always great to have new friends. And Rion. Rion is another new friend. I just met Rion a few days ago. Welcome, Rion. Welcome, Rion.
Hi, friend. Hi. Yeah, it's great to be here. Thank you for inviting me. And hello to everybody in the audience that I've not seen before. And hello to Dan, my friend.
And That Being Said is here too. Hello, That Being Said.
And That Being Said.
Rion, I don't know if everybody in my audience knows you. You are certainly fairly new to me, so I'm going to let you start by introducing yourself and telling us a little bit about your story.
Sure. So I grew up, for the most part, a Jehovah's Witness. I kind of am born in, not necessarily, but the first like 5 to 10 years of my life were pretty, I don't want to say traumatic, but they were rife with a lot of strife. So even though I wasn't necessarily born in, I still had a lot of contact with like the Jehovah's Witnesses. And eventually my parents converted, got baptized. So for the most part, my brain is wired as somebody who grew up in a high control religion. And I like to make sure that I explain that to people, because many times they have no idea that the Jehovah's Witnesses, cult, high control religion, whatever you prefer to call it. I'm trying to move away from the word cult because it seems to turn people off. But a high control religion, because they just picture the Jehovah's Witnesses as these nice people that go door to door and don't realize that they have a lot of really bad theologies and doctrine and dogma that harm people. So I got baptized in the religion when I was 15 years old. And unfortunately, I ended up getting disfellowshipped, which means you get completely cut off from the religion. So the people that you grew up with, your friends, whatnot, they shun you, they shut you off. So that was really, that was a lot of turmoil. And very depressing. And by the way, I was pregnant. That's why I got disfellowshipped. That's why I got disfellowship. But you see what I'm saying? Like, why these rules are so harsh? Like, I was a dumb kid having sex, like whatever. And I get pregnant. And here, when I need people, like I'm at my lowest, and I get ostracized from every freaking thing that I'd ever known. And not only that, I thought I was going to die. Like I seriously knew that the end of the world was coming. And when the end came, not only am I going to die, but I'm going to be responsible for the death of my child. So some really traumatic stuff that you're attached to this religion. Like, you constantly like are in this trauma bond. You're going back and forth trying to do better and heal. And then you sin, and kind of throws your mind for a loop. And that's why here I am at 40 something years old, trying to now like detach all these ideas and figure out who I am, because everything that I was mm-hmm. given to me. You know, it was taught to me, this is who you are, this is what you do, this is how we A, B, C, D, everything's laid out for you. So mm-hmm. now I'm like, who am I? What do I like to wear? Like, mm-hmm. Like simple things sometimes it's just like I've got to figure this out now. And I think
I can completely relate.
Yeah. Right. It's kind of weird figuring out.
Yeah. The religion that I was in was mainstream. So it was not as culty. Mm-hmm. It was not as mind controlling, but it was almost as bad. Now, my guest last week was Dave Warnock, and he went through a very similar. Mm-hmm. He went through a very similar experience as you, in that he was shunned by his church, and mm-hmm. he was shunned for he had no idea what. He didn't even know what it was that he allegedly did wrong. I you know, having read
Despicable. The
book, he doesn't say it directly, but I really think he was shunned because the lead pastor was jealous. The lead pastor had a mega church and started several satellites, and Dave was the pastor of one of the satellites, and his satellite church was growing while the lead pastor's church was shrinking. And mm-hmm. the lead pastor accused Dave of being rebellious and not following his leadership. And that's what he was shunned for, being rebellious and not following leadership. And really what it came down to was just petty jealousy.
Right. It's arbitrary, silly, nonsensical human things, mm-hmm. because it's all human. Sorry, but mm-hmm. the entire thing, start to finish, the foundation, it's all human in my book. And to treat people like that is, it's so harmful. People die because of being shunned. It's mm-hmm. it's not a good place to put people in, again, especially if they're at the lowest point and they need help. And you're just saying, oh, we're done with you. You're trash. And then you add on top of it, you think God hates you and you're invisible. And mm-hmm. when the end comes, he's not even going to see you because you're disfellowshipped. You're shunned. It's really frightening. You kind of live in fear. Well, you always live in fear, but you really are fearful if you believe, like if you really believe it, and which at that time I still believed it. Mm-hmm. So, mm-hmm. yeah, I don't know much more what I can say about the religion part, but as far as like my life, I did eventually leave around in my 20s because I got married to what they call a worldly person. But that relationship was not good because I did not know what love was, did not know what the heck I was looking for, and ended up leaving and going back to the religion. And there was this, a lot of this back and forth with the religion because I never deconstructed. So mm-hmm. I still had that mentality that was pulling me back in. Mm-hmm. And now is like the point of no return because I finally did the work. So I try mm-hmm. to tell people all the time, like you have to do the work before you get sucked in to something else at least, or sucked mm-hmm. back in to the old, you know, like the Bible says, a dog returning to its vomit. Just saying, we don't want to do that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, another thing I can relate to is when you talked about, you know, you got kicked out for being pregnant. Now, that was not my issue, but there were three girls in my daughter's graduating class that all got pregnant during, one got pregnant during her sophomore year, and one got pregnant during her junior year, and one got pregnant during her senior year. No, I take it back. The other two both got pregnant during their junior year. But anyway, the one that got pregnant during sophomore year was fortunate because she got pregnant very toward the end of the year, found out she was pregnant during the summer, and she simply withdrew from school and didn't go back. Mm-hmm. But the other two were caught pregnant at a Baptist school. And so they were expelled. And this was one of the first major fractures to my faith, is I looked at that and I looked at, you know, how many times do I forgive my brother? 70 times seven. Mm-hmm. So why can't we forgive these girls? And as soon as the girls were expelled, they go to the public high school. And I'm going, why is the public high school able to forgive them, but the Christian high school can't? Mm-hmm. And the rationale they gave was, well, we don't want to look like we're condoning sin. Well, okay, but you forgive almost any other transgression. The only transgressions they get expelled for are drugs and pregnancy. So why are those the unforgivable sins? You know, the Bible doesn't say those are unforgivable sins. And yet in the Christian community, they were.
Yeah. And I think that's one of my issues. One of my big issues with sin is everything is lumped in into this definition, right? Like some things that are super egregious are lumped into something simple as I don't believe in God, right? Mm-hmm, because it's mm-hmm. a sin not to believe in God. So I'm just as terrible as this person who's done some.
Yeah.
Right. Like Come on. That, and I don't know if you've, if y'all have seen like the media of people tweeting, these Christians tweeting about how Dahmer and whatnot are going to go to heaven. And I'm like, no, like I'm not even going to heaven and he ain't going to heaven. Nope, 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 not happening. Like it's absolutely abhorrent that this is the kind of stuff that can be forgiven, but somebody who is in need, who's human, who wants to feel good, who has desires that want to be fulfilled, no big deal, right? Mm-hmm. But, oh, disgusting. You know why? Because the church wants to own you. Mm-hmm. They want to own your mind. Exactly. And if they can own your sexuality, your passion, your desires, your fun. I mean, our body is a playland. our body's like a water park. I mean, no, come
your
on.
Your body is the temple of the Holy Spirit.
Right? So, So they've got you under control. And if you can control like that one particular part of people's psyche, like you got, I mean, look at society. We're still fighting to have rights for LGBTQIA people. Mm-hmm. It's wild what they're trying to force people to be unnatural to what is actually natural to them. Anyway,
I need to answer Sandy's question. Do they kick out the baby daddies? And the answer is one of the girls, the dad was a student. And yes, he was expelled also. The other girl, the dad was a public school student. So the church had no control over him and the school had no control over him. But yes, they did kick out the one dad that also was attending the school.
I guarantee you that statistically, obviously, I have no idea what the statistics are because I don't even know that the Jehovah's Witnesses keep those kind of records. But I guarantee you that scenario for scenario, that if it's a girl who has sex versus a guy who has sex, who is more than likely forgiven. And I guarantee that it's not going to be the girl who's forgiven more than likely. I bet you she'll be the one punished. Mm-hmm. I mean, we've seen it happen in abuse cases where they will shun the child who has an accusation, who gets harmed, to keep them silent. So it's a disgusting little game that they play with people.
Yeah. YouTube Punk has a question that I don't know the answer to, but will get us onto the topic for the night. Wasn't The Philosophy of Time the book in Donnie Darko? I don't know what Donnie Darko is. Do you?
I don't. Isn't that a movie or book series?
I don't know.
Comic series? Oof. I feel really terrible because I know it's in my brain, but I'm not sure exactly. But that's how most things are in my brain, so...
I've taken no notice. I've reached the age now where I'm going, that's after my time. I don't keep up with that modern stuff.
Too much.
Oh wait, YouTube Bug says that's an old movie. Okay, then I guess I should know it, but I don't. I'm not familiar with the movie. Okay, I'll tell you how today's topic came up.
And it's probably from the 80s, and they think that's old.
Oh, yeah, 80s is not old. 60s and 70s is old, but 80s definitely is not old.
Sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt, but that just cracked me up.
That's okay, because Sandy says it may still be after our time. Okay, anyway, the way that the topic came up, first, it was an idea that I found very interesting is I heard a couple people say that, what do you mean? Okay. Libera says Donnie Darko was 2001.
Old.
What do you mean that's old? 2001.
I'm
going to
pass away.
Old?
Excuse me. Excuse me.
Goodness, that's the same age as my youngest child.
Oh, no. Oh, my God. Eef.
I've got grandkids almost that old.
Sheesh.
Right. Anyway, we're never going to get onto a topic, but here we go. somebody said that because time, that the concept of before time is an incoherent concept. And that was a revolutionary idea to me. And I started thinking about it and I thought, you know, that has to be right because before relates to time. So if time does not exist, how can there be a before? But I've never really delved into the philosophy of it. And I let that go for a bit, but then another philosophy of time came up, question came up in my interview with Dr. Ryan Mullins, which is he said that time is linear. And I have always thought of time as being linear. And yet believers have told me you can't think of time as being linear because God is outside of time. For us, time is linear, but for God, it is not. And he disagreed with that. He said that, you know, time has to be the same for God as it is for everyone else. So I decided I wanted to have a stream on the philosophy of time. And I posted in a creator's chat room that this is what I wanted to do. And Wes Sturtevant said he would find me some people who were good at philosophy. And he gave me Ryan's name. And so I asked Ryan on, thinking Ryan is a philosopher.
No. Ryan is just learning how to use her brain. What are you talking about, Wes? I should have said something when he told me the topic. I just felt like we were going to I didn't know.
Okay. So we're going to try to muddle through this a little bit. Anyone in the chat that is versed in philosophy, please feel free to comment. Or if you even want to jump into the stream, let me know and I'll send you a link. Better yet, here's what I'm going to do. I'm just going to put a link right into the chat. And if anybody who is versed in philosophy wants to join us, please feel free. All right. I'm going to pin that so that anyone can get that. There we go. And we will just go ahead and talk about this as much as we can. And if we just don't have the expertise to talk about this, we'll talk about something else. And another night, I'll try to get someone who is more versed in philosophy than we are.
Someone who knows what they're talking about.
Yeah. Normally I go straight to Trolley Dave. Trolley Dave is normally the person that answers my philosophy questions, but I did not ask him for one reason. Trolley Dave lives in the UK. It's 2 o'clock in the morning right now.
Yeah, the time difference.
Yeah, and so it's awful. I did ask 2 other people that I knew were good at philosophy, but both of them said that this was not a good night for them and they couldn't make it. So I said, okay, well, we'll just go with Ryan.
We'll settle for Ryan. Sure. I'm sorry, it's just too funny.
Yeah, it is funny. Johnny says, think of time as a thread on a spool. It's linear from our perspective, but some moments are wound next to each other that would be in the past or the future from our point of view. Sort of like a wrinkle in time. You know, in the story A Wrinkle in Time, they talk about time, that if you want to travel through time, you need to find a way to wrinkle it so that you take our part of the thread and this future part of the thread and bring them together. And then you can travel a short distance and you can travel through time.
Interesting way of seeing it. I'd not thought of that perspective, but I absolutely enjoy hearing these perspectives. Now, do I have them myself? Probably.
Well, Wrinkle in Time is fiction.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, I can tell you what the Jehovah's Witnesses think. God thinks of time, 1,000 years is a day. There you go.
Yep.
Made up philosophy. How do we like that?
Yep. Yep.
I don't even know if a tesseract could help me right now.
A tesseract is what they use to create the wrinkles in time in the book Wrinkle in Time. Peyton Dooley says string theory. And I don't know if that was what Johnny was just explaining, because I know nothing about string theory. I've heard the term, but I don't know anything about it. YouTube Puck says spool theory.
Right. Is spool theory string theory? Somebody?
I don't know.
Anybody? Bueller, help us.
Johnny says A Wrinkle in Time is one of the best adaptations of a book into a movie. Yeah, true. True.
I'll have to see that. I've not seen that one.
Peyton says string theory is theoretical physics. Yeah, yeah. That's why it's a little above my pay grade. I struggled through high school physics, and that's all the physics that I've gone through.
Yeah, I don't even think that I had that. I think I was in remedial stuff. Dumb cult kid.
Purple brings up something that's so true, and I was watching it in a video just earlier today, where Vice Rhino was taking apart Bodhi Hodge. To God, 1,000 years is in a day, except in Genesis, where it is exactly 24 hours.
Yeah, where he sets the moon and the sun, and, you know, he separates the day from the night. Yeah. 24 hours. Interesting. Yeah.
So, Ryan, do you think it is possible for there to be such a thing as before time?
That was a good question. Before time. I mean, because it really kind of blows my mind when you do start to think about it, like, what did people do before they had the concept of timekeeping, calendars and whatnot? Like, what was going through their mind? And I wouldn't have a clue, because it's just how we live our day now. We're
concepts of time have been understood since the earliest hominids. That would make an interesting experiment. I should ask Gutsy Gibbon if primates are time aware. I think they are.
Because
they can certainly see when it's day and when it's night, and they do different things in the day than in the night. So I think humans have always been aware of time. One thing I learned in Assassin's Creed that was interesting to me was, in ancient Egypt, they had clocks for the night. They used sundials in the daytime, and at night they had large vessels that they would fill with water that had a hole in the bottom of them so the water would drip out. And there were lines on the vessel. So you just look at what level the water was at to see what time it was all during the night. And when you get ready to go to bed, you fill the vessel with water.
That's so smart and so inventive. And people think, like, that our ancestors were these, I don't know, I think they feel like they're so rudimentary, but they were really developing concepts that we'd be nowhere if they hadn't developed them. I mean, building everything. Yeah. Well, all of their beliefs are pretty much ridiculous and made up and conspiratorial. It's just how it is.
When I was a believer, we always considered Jehovah's Witnesses to be a cult. Now, we would never say that to their faces, because we knew they didn't like that. But we would have whole classes taught on why the Jehovah's Witnesses were wrong and what they teach, and if they come to your door, what to say to them. We had whole classes on that.
Oh, wowzies. That's interesting. I mean, I think that's probably a smart thing to do. I feel like everybody should have some kind of classes on really just all high control religions and the systems that they use. I think that would be time better spent. But of course, everybody wants to point the finger, like, when it comes to religion. They can't break down the bite model stuff, or then everybody would leave.
That being said, says, in existentialism, time only matters in terms of one's life. We spend our lives battling against our own death, whereupon time ceases to matter.
Oof.
Purple says, to me, a cyclic universe seems to make the most sense. The universe expands until it runs out of energy, then it collapses back to a single point. Then it erupts again to form a new universe, repeat and infinitum. That is a really interesting concept, Purple. I have heard of the bounce theory of the universe, but I have never understood how it works. I just knew that it existed. But this is quite interesting.
Yeah, I like the idea of that. And it sounds totally, totally plausible. For that to be how it happens. Just how long does that take to exist, and how many times, like, is it happening? everywhere else.
It's also interesting to discuss it with someone who wants to argue the Kalam cosmological argument with you and say everything that begins to exist. Now I can't even remember it. All of a sudden I'm drawing a blank. And then you make the argument that the universe didn't begin to exist. And that one throws them for a loop because normally everyone agrees to that part. Okay, yes, the universe began to exist. Everything that begins to exist has a cause. The universe began to exist, therefore the universe has a cause. That's the argument. And Okay. Yeah, when you argue that, no, we don't know that the universe began to exist. It might have, and it might not have. We really don't know.
Right. It's those things that I hadn't really thought about that too much, but right. We don't know. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. There's no answers to any of these things. They're all, I mean, some are better guesses and better theories than others, way mm-hmm. better than probably ones I could come up with, but better than 1,000 years to a day. What caused God to do this? I don't know.
Peyton says, we don't know if there was a before time. We can't see beyond the Big Bang. Yeah. Yeah, that's true. Logan Fisher says, we've been modern humans for longer than written word. Very true. Very true. Purple says, water clocks were great, except in northern country in the winter when they would freeze. Very good Ooh. Point. Very good yeah. point. 1,000 years is a day is how they came up with 1975 in part.
Yeah, there's a lot of different. That's one of the doomsday prophecies.
Okay.
That the Jehovah's Witnesses have. Yeah. Doomsday cult. They got to have like an end time. Unfortunately, mm-hmm. now they've realized that they got to be very careful because many of their all of their prophecies did not come true. 75 is just one of them.
One of the things that we laughed at Jehovah Witnesses for in our church was that when I was first a Christian, Jehovah Witnesses said that the I'm trying to remember the number of people in Revelation. There was 100,000, or I can't remember what it was. And Jehovah's Witnesses, those are the Jehovah's Witnesses. Mm-hmm. And as soon as the number of Jehovah's Witnesses reaches 100,000 or whatever the number was, Christ will return. And then yeah. they reach that number in like, I don't know, 1980, 1982. And God didn't come back, Christ didn't return, and so then they had changed the prophecy.
Yes, so the 144,000 is, I think it's mentioned. It's mentioned, I think, one time. I'm sure if there's any Jehovah's Witnesses in there, they can tell me. I believe it might be mentioned one time mm-hmm. in Revelations, and the Jehovah's Witnesses created a whole theology around it and a whole group of people that they could control. But tell them they had a promise. They had a special promise because the 144,000 get to go to heaven, but I, as a regular Jehovah's Witness, don't go to heaven. I have to go through Armageddon and all that stuff. Well, if I live to see it, but I would go through Armageddon to get to the paradise on the other side. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But the 144,000, they're chosen by God and they get to be kings and queens. And rule us a perfect society forever and ever. Amen.
Yeah. Originally, that was all the Jehovah's Witnesses. S.J. Thomason is here. Welcome, S.J. S.J. is a Catholic. And so it is nice to see someone here that has a different opinion.
Yes. I'm always open to hear different people's opinions. I might not agree with them. I will tell them what I think, but... I mean, that's what it's about, to talk and have discussions. Just hopefully people can be open-minded.
Purple makes a very good point here. If you're going to give a prophecy date, make sure it's after you're dead.
Hold on, I got to write this down. Notes for when I become a prophet. Okay, thank you. Got to make sure. Okay, yes, thank you, Darth. Just once. Yeah, I mean, they take so many things where it's just mentioned one time, and they just pull, they cherry pick just like every other religion does. It's what they're good at. The math. Yeah, well, the math does not math. The math is never mathed for that organization, nor any other organization who predicts the end times. And the thing is, what I don't understand is these apocalyptic groups have been happening since like the 1700s. Mm-hmm. How do they continue to, they just resurface and resurface and rebrand. And every time something doesn't come true, they just change a little bit. And don't die off already.
Don't forget the great disappointment.
Oh, I was just talking to my friends today about that. I was like, did you guys hear about the great disappointment? Like, what a freaking terrible, like, so 1844, right? The great disappointment, the Millerites, what's his name? Mm-hmm. Something Miller. I can't remember.
I don't remember his first name, but you're right. It was the Millerites. Yep.
Yeah. The Millerites. Mm-hmm. This guy gets a brainiac idea to interpret, I believe it was Daniel and maybe even part of Habakkuk, and decided that it listed a certain amount of days. And so he took those days and said it. This is another one of those time things. They're trying to time travel. So he took the amount of days in Daniel, so a prophecy in Daniel, and then made it complete into his prophecy and added up his calculations and came up with 1844. And
Jay says 1843.
William it was Miller. 1843. It was 1843. And then they had like this short window of time where they're like, oh, I think the calculations were a little bit off. Let's push it out. And they push it out till March of like 1844. But yeah, after that, it completely fractured. And then that's how you get like the Jehovah's Witnesses, the Seventh-day Adventists, and I believe even like the Mormons, and there's probably some other ones in there, but it's like this little tree that just went and grew, and then the apples fell and then they grow.
Purple says, the world has ended at least 2 dozen times since I was born. Yep.
Yeah.
Have you seen, I believe it's Telltale's things on Cat. I can't remember Cat's last name. Somebody in the chat will know. She makes prophecies about end times all the time. And, you know, and she'll have the world ending in a week. And then when it doesn't, I was off. I miscalculated this. It's next week. And, you know, it's in 3 days. And, you know, Cat Kerr, there we go. Cat Kerr.
Okay.
Constantly predicting the end of the world.
There's a lot of them. Mm-hmm. There are, and you know what's really disturbing? I know this is off topic. I'm sorry, but just mentioning that, what I feel is like really disturbing is this new age. Well, it's not even new age. It's been going around for a long time, but this new spiritism of like manifestation and everything that happens to you, you've manifested. And there is just so many holes, and it's so problematic, and it hurts so many people because how did people who were enslaved manifest being enslaved? How did a child who's assaulted manifest being assaulted? Like for cute little things, yeah, you can make it sound really good. Like, yeah, my prayer came true, right? When Christians pray, something comes true. It was all God. Something bad happens, it was Satan. Well, we manifest all these good things. Oh, okay. I found $10 on the floor. That's great. But then if you get like a beat down, something bad happens to you. You get cancer, right? You didn't manifest that. That's really toxic. It's the end of the world as we know it, and I'm not fine. Can't lie.
Jenny says, I saw a doomsday prophet in a sandwich board with a megaphone on June 6th, 2006.
Yeah, where's he at now? That's what I want to see. How's business? This is what I need to know.
He probably just repainted the sign to say 2026.
Yeah. See, but that is exactly how religion is created and repackaged. It's people reacting to what's happening to the world around them. And when these prophecies that they build up in their heart that are going to come true, when they don't come true, they have this like fracture, this cognitive dissonance, and they go, oh shit, Like, we've got to, like, something's got to give, something's got to change. And either they accept, and like me, you finally break out of it, you break out of the shell, or you just go deeper and you change the prophecy. Mm-hmm. And that's literally the entirety of the Bible. Help me, Jesus, please. Why don't people get that? Sorry, tangent.
Logan Fisher says, guess he has to wait until 6666.
That's a long time.
It is. You could make that prophecy. And of course, you know, that prophecy isn't going to compel anyone to believe, though, because Jesus could come back any day was one of the things that caused me to become a believer when I did. You know, I was mulling it over and thinking it through. Is this right? And the friends that were telling me about the gospel were saying, Jesus could come back tomorrow. You know, if you don't accept Christ now, he could come back tomorrow and you don't get to go to heaven. So you got to do this now. But if we predict it's not coming until 6666, people, all right, I just need to believe sometime before I die.
Right. But I think that's probably one of the biggest parts of like being in a religion that's always predicting the end times. They cling on to that right around the corner any day now. I mean, it is just
exactly
they have honed in on that scripture. And it's so funny because, like, when will enough be enough? Like, okay, it's been how many thousands of years will pass and you're still going to say, any minute, at what point are you going to accept that our ancestors were fools?
But a thousand years is but a day. You know, we've only gone through two right? days since Jesus died.
It's only been two days. It's this circular logic in this cycle that just keeps, like, oh God, help me. It's like Groundhog Day every freaking day. Yeah. Groundhog religion. That's what it is. It's Groundhog religion. We just keep reliving the same scenario, but differently somehow.
Next Y2K is 2038. Really? Explain that, Johnny. I don't know what you mean. Is there something about computers that 2038 is going to... Uh-oh. Bumblebee is here. Hello, Bumblebee. No. Oh, it's Bree. Hi, Bree. Yes, I didn't even recognize you. Your hair is so different.
Yeah, I'm just doing different stuff. It's gotten long enough I can do different stuff with it now. So I'm like,
ooh. It looks cute.
I'm like girling out because I have never been able to do it before. So,
oh, that's awesome. Yeah. Love it.
But yeah, time, it's on our side.
Do you know about time? Because I think Godless Granley chose the the wrong person, not her fault, the wrong person for time. So if you've got some inside information.
Well, I think that's a fundament. So time, just in and of itself, I think is a fundamental, like we talk about young earth creation and stuff like that. That's the fundamental problem there. Flat earth stuff too is thinking of deep space and deep time together. It's just too much of it's too much for someone to wrap their head around. Millions of years, get a little billions of years, they can't comprehend something like that. It doesn't fit inside the box for them, the box of what they accept as reality. So most of them are adhering to like an A theory of time, though, which is kind of throws those things. And I don't like talking about philosophy a lot, but A theory, you all know A theory, B theory, right?
No, what is that? Actually, I want to put you on pause for just a minute, okay, because there's something I've been waiting to bring up. And that is with regards to the end times, one of the best responses to that is Bart Ehrman. Because Bart Ehrman makes the argument that Jesus expected to return before his own disciples died. And if Jesus got it wrong, then obviously we shouldn't be waiting for it any longer.
That seems sensible to me. Why is that so sensible?
Wait, say that again.
Jesus expected to return before all of his disciples died. Now, you know, there's the verse in John saying,
some of you will still be alive.
Right. Some of you will not taste death before the Son of Man returns again. And The author of John puts in this note that, well, he wasn't saying that all of them would live or that any of them would live. And that's the interpretation that they have now. Well, he wasn't saying that they would live, but Bart Ehrman says, no, that's exactly what he was saying.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, Paul's, in my opinion, Paul's authentic letters, it's in his opinion that it's like immediate. Like he's right. like frantically, right. like it's coming any day now. And that exactly. could have been because he's seeing what's happening and like,
well, they've been the apostles like that dying off or whatever. Years, right.
Well, they've never stopped.
It started with Paul and we just kept going.
Yeah. Failed prophecy, new religion, which is, I believe, the apocalyptic stuff, is because like it's not happening, it's not coming back, and they've got to like
I have a keep pet people theory holding on. about that. It's like Mesopotamia, right? It was this lush land full of agriculture and everything for a long, long mm-hmm. time. And they didn't know a lot about like crop rotation and how to sustain the land and keep it arable. But so it turned into a desert, and they watched the land around them slowly turn from this jungle, and they killed off all the megafauna. There were lions and tigers and bears. all living in the same region together and everything because of the lush habitat. And humankind congregated there and just decimated the land. And it's still, a lot of it's still useless land today around that area. But so they thought they look around and all these fabled creatures have disappeared. All the croplands are dying. They're getting hit with plagues and famine. And there's all these other kingdoms coming in and trampling over them, walking right over them on their way to have their wars with other kingdoms fighting over their land. They were living in their apocalypse, right?
Well, that's what, I mean, that's really what is happening with like Isaiah and Jeremiah, right? I mean, mm-hmm. they're mm-hmm. looking at the impending doom of like these kingdoms, like of Assyria, of Medo-Persia. Like it's obvious that they, like I said, are reacting to what is happening around them. They make a little prophecy here and there. And then the next guy comes along. And he's like, well, it wasn't exactly this. It was that. Like everybody's like capping for the next guy. Everybody's like covering for the last dude. Like, oh, you got it wrong, but here we go.
Ironic that you like Kat Kerr, like she was like Kelly was talking about. She was she makes those prophecies like that. They hedge their bets now. Just keep hedging them, hedging them. Mm-hmm. All right.
Oh. Okay, Bree. So, what are the A theory and the B theory of time?
Okay, so
oh yeah,
no, this is just I didn't come in here mean to come in here and derail the biblical talk, but so A theory of time is that time is linear. It has a it goes whether it has a starting point or not. Obviously, in the theology of the Abrahamic faith, it has a starting point and let there be light and goes on and. Matter and space are independent of that. Time has always been going and always will keep going independent of matter and space. And B theory of time, which is what most physicists would adhere to, what most scientists would probably adhere to, would be the idea that space, time, and matter are tethered together. And I mean, this is, of course, theory of relativity is a theory, but I mean, you fall into that just a theory gap here, but it's all tethered to this idea that time is relative to space and matter, right?
I see. Okay. Yeah.
So that's why when you're moving and someone else is standing still, time is actually going faster for you. Like if you're on a bus. Oh, no, wait, I got that backwards. Sorry, I got that absolutely backwards. When you're moving, time slows down. Sorry for anybody listening out there. I got that totally backwards when I said that.
How dare you?
Yeah.
Okay, so one question I have. The theory of relativity, is that a scientific theory the way the theory of gravity and the theory of evolution are mm-hmm. theories which are essentially proven to be fact? Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, and so they're better people to dive into physics than me, but I did want to come in here and just bring that up when you all were discussing, because they have a start point and end point, right? And it's just they just keep stretching out how long it is on an A theory plane, right? And anything that happens within that is separate from this destined timeline. Whereas when we think of time, that's why people are like, oh, what was before the Big Bang is totally nonsensical, because time is tethered to that. So there was no time before time. That doesn't make any sense. That's north of the North Pole. What are you talking about? So there doesn't have to be anything before that state, because there's no before, because before is a causal, is a causal position, right?
So time cannot exist without matter either.
Right. Right. And that's B theory. And as it expands, well, there was a point where it was speeding up. I think where most of the universe is slowing down now, at least most of the visible universe. And if I say anything wrong to anybody out there in the chat has the proper credentials about how the redshift is reflected, please correct me. I don't want to be up here spouting bullshit. I'm just explaining what I understand from watching lots and lots of Leo Felius's stuff.
Leo is the person that I most wanted to have in here, but unfortunately he was busy today and couldn't make it.
Yeah. And
I think that
it makes sense, because at least I understand what you're saying. So if you can get me to get it.
Well,
all right. We have an idea going on here.
Quinn knows about redshift.
I just learned about redshift quite recently. I heard Vice Rhino mention it, and I criticized him for mentioning it without explaining it. I said, I don't know what that is. I have to go look it up.
It's the color spectrum, though. It's the rainbow. It's fun to learn about, right?
Right. It was fun to learn. And what was really interesting is on New Year's Eve or New Year's Day. No, I guess it was New Year's Eve. My daughter went around the room, was asking different questions about the year. And one of the questions she was asked was, name one thing new you learned this year. And when she got to me, I said, I learned what redshift is. And I said, it's. And she said, wait a minute, is this child appropriate? And I said, yes, redshift is child appropriate. It's a science term.
Let's check Urban Dictionary for that term.
Right? Like, uh-oh, might have another meaning. Alternative meaning.
Yeah. But that's how we deduce certain aspects of the age of the universe. Not all of them. There's other we use a lot of different methods to make those calculations, but that's like the right there at the axis of being a pinnacle of what we understand so far. And it's based on the way that that light reaches us here on our little blue dot floating around the sun. Beautiful. But yeah, was there any,
you mean it's not a flat earth? You mean the sun isn't,
oh my god,
inside the firmament? Flat
earth. I see
Mars. There's no pillars under the earth either.
What's holding up the earth? Wait, maybe it's
falling forever. Cause
where's
it falling into?
No, Atlas is holding it up, isn't he?
Elephants and turtles.
Speaking of flat earth, Mark Reed posted a video this morning or last night, maybe, of the conversation with the most toxic flat earther I had ever heard. It was,
oh dear,
oh my gosh, he wouldn't even stop talking. I don't
that's
know
when,
how you
that's
do it,
when
Mark.
You're glad that as the host that you can mute your guests if you want to.
Yeah,
I feel like so many people are like disassociating, disconnecting. Like, how do they believe this far out, nonsensical, from science-based ideas? I don't understand.
It's so funny because you hear the flat or the young earth creationists making fun of the flat earthers,
right? Like, you're not much better.
And most flat earthers are young earth creationists. Most of them that I've interacted with, or at least they don't accept the what we call it, uniformitarian timeline. They don't accept that. So they don't think the earth is as old as we say it is, or that humans are billions of years old. There's all kinds of different threads you could go down.
Yeah. So I think Jehovah's Witnesses think the earth is, they're young earth creationists, but I think some of them may feel like there's a possibility that God created the earth, but then it existed for a long time before he actually made humans. So it could be like billions of years old, but he didn't create humans until like a few thousand years ago. I'm like, it still doesn't world. Make sense. Yeah. Okay. But you still think, like, do you think that the entire Earth could be populated like it is from two people? I don't. I feel like it would not work. It would collapse.
Population, maybe?
Yeah.
Ryan, we're getting an echo from you. I don't know why.
Is it? It might be from me, her coming through mine. So let me turn.
Okay. Let's.
It might be me.
Okay.
What about now?
Hello.
Now we're good.
Okay.
All right. So, what were we talking about?
Young Earth, old Earth. How long have humans been on this planet?
Is there an old Earth creationist in the chat? Because I'd like to talk to one at some point. There's things
I was one. First, I was a young Earther, and then I went to the Shedd Aquarium.
Yeah.
And then I wasn't a young Earther anymore. And the reason was because one of the things that they told us as a young Earther was fish cannot grow lungs and crawl out of the water. So when I went to the Shedd Aquarium and I saw lungfish, I went, they lied. Those right? are fish with lungs. I can see them. They're right there in front of me. So that was the end of young Earth for me.
Fish evolved in anaerobic environments where there was no oxygen in the water. So they pulled it out from the above and then had the gas pocket that they held it in, right? And that's where our lungs come from.
So at that point, I became an old earther. And Maya says, what's an old earther? An old earther is someone that... Okay, now I'm echoing. An old earther is someone who... Now it's stopped. Okay, good. Is someone who believes that the Earth is 13 billion years old, or however old the scientists say, and that humans did evolve, but God guided the process, that God got involved by... especially creating along the way. But the key to being an old earther is you can't put much thought into it. Because once young earth broke for me, I became an old earther. But if someone had ever challenged me, and I'm echoing again, sorry. If anyone had ever challenged me on, how did humans evolve? And then Adam and Eve came along. That was something that never occurred to me to think about. And that's something that I challenge old earthers all the time. Okay, were Adam and Eve then mythological figures? And that's the position of some old earthers, is that those are just mythological figures. Okay, fine. But if Adam and Eve are mythological figures, Adam is in Jesus' genealogy. Mm-hmm. How can a real person be a descendant of a mythological figure? Mm-hmm. Now, Dr. Swamidas has a theory that solves that problem, that he says that Adam and Eve were specially created, that hominids existed, early humans existed, and God created Adam and Eve special. And they're the ones that sinned, and eventually all of the progeny of the prior, of the other humans died out. And all humans existing today are the progeny of Adam and Eve, even though that's some of horrible. Adam and Eve did.
Ooh, that explains the land and nod, though.
Right. It does. But here's the problem.
Genesis 1 explains nod, though. Genesis 1 is a completely different. Anyway, sorry.
Yeah, well.
Sorry. Land of nod.
It's okay. How do you think? How do you say that Genesis 1 explains the land of Nod? That those are other.
It's a separate event from Genesis 2.
Genesis 1 is one creation event. That's El and the Elohim, so the Canaanite gods, and then Genesis 2 is Yahweh, and that's where we see Adam and Eve. So Genesis 1 is where we create man in our image, and man and women are created at the same time and in different orders. Like, stuff is in different order in 1 from 2. But 2 is specifically for Yahweh, where he handcrafts Adam and Eve from the ground. Yeah.
Now, I always heard a very different explanation.
But that, I think that's like the Jewish like that the Jewish accepted that that's what happened. That's how Cain had could find a wife, because there were other people made in chapter one.
Okay. That makes a lot more sense than the biblical literalism that I was taught. But if you go with the biblical literalism, if Adam and Eve were created alongside other people, those other people either A, had to be sinless, because original sin had not yet happened. The first, and Romans, it's 6:23. I forget which one it is, but through one man, all sin entered the world. Through Adam, sin entered the world.
Right.
Well, if other people were sinless, then all have sinned is false. If the other people had sinned, then sin entering the world through Adam is false. Either way, you're going to falsify part of Romans by going to that theory.
Yeah, it all falls apart when you really start to try to weave it together. You can't weave it together because you got a hole in your sweater. It doesn't work.
You need a
Lilith is from one. So Lilith, that's where Lilith. Yeah.
You actually comes need from one to one. Justify like the war with the angels and all that stuff, right? Before,
oh honey, that's some of my favorite stuff. I love talking about like the Nephilim and the angels coming down, Benny Elohim.
Have you been to my channel? Because that's what I talk
about. Well, excuse me, I will be making sure that I follow you because that is what I talk about.
I follow you on Instagram too.
Oh, do you? Okay, well, I have to make sure that I follow you because I love talking about like the Beniha Elohim and the other gods that came before God. I mean, that's how God came to be, because he stole all the other properties from the other dudes, the other gods.
And I love Mark Green. Enoch is... You take Enoch and you stick it in there, and it takes like the Old Testament and it turns into like an epic fantasy. Because Enoch,
it makes it so much fun.
It turns Yahweh so flawed, and he's such a angry, bitter child of a god. When you get petulant. To see how he acts,
me.
Gives him depth. He's like, I am so jealous, and I don't care who knows it.
Right, he is a jealous god. You know, I don't think that's ever been something that he's hidden from people, which fascinates me about Christianity, that God is a jealous God, but then they got this dude they worship. Like, okay, tell me how that parses out. Okay.
And then one of the rules is like, go ahead. I'm sorry, Kelly.
I was just going to answer Johnny's question that Lilith is from Jewish scripture. It's also in the Apocrypha.
Is Lilith, Lilith canon when you add Enoch? I don't think you can get away from her at that point, right?
I mean, she's in there, isn't she?
Yeah, I think she is. She's
not in the Protestant Bible.
No, we're talking. So Enoch is extra biblical or apocrypha, but it is included in the canon of the Ethiopian Orthodox, and they're the ones who think who claim to have the Ark of the Covenant in the in one of their churches. They have a whole. They have a whole different outlook on Christianity. There's different from what grew around the Catholic Church as you can possibly be and still be a Christian. They're separate from, most modern Christianity is descent from either Catholicism, a schism from Catholicism, or a schism from Eastern Orthodox, right? I mean, even that's a schism from the Roman Catholic Church, but this one's separate. This one branched off before any of that. So there are this kind of unique African sect of Christians, and they believe they have the Ark of the Covenant. They have a lot of mythology about Christian, how Christianity came to their land. It's worth looking into.
There is only one verse about Enoch in the Protestant Bible, which is Enoch walked with God, so God took him. That's it. That's all it says about him.
That's so it in Enoch, there's a which book is it? It's there's a part where it talks about Noah's birth, that he was born albino.
Really?
Albino in the Apocrypha.
I didn't know that. That's too funny. Yeah. And they think that an albino had a, they think that an albino had a man, a son who turned black.
Yeah, which is him. Yes.
I'm laughing because it's
most did you know that the black Hebrew Israelites, they own that and say that they are the true.
Yeah, lies, false. I'm sorry. The whole religion's just bogus, like most of them. Yeah, they tried, but they failed. It's all like mistranslation. I've looked into it. It's just all manipulation. It's, again, that cherry-picked stuff.
Well, they claim to land in North America, too, that this is these are lands that are gift, like Israel was to the
Israelites,
the land of Canaan, how
parsed out Israel
back then, the land of Canaan, how that was to the Israelites, that
inheritance, is an inheritance, yeah,
yes, and we're just the we're the scumbags living on the land that they get to, that they get to righteously drive off and kill, leave none alive. What is the verse, Kelly? Leave none alive.
You can save. Kill them all, man, woman, and child. Is that are you talking about the cleansing of Canaan?
Yeah.
Is that from the Midianites?
Oh, the Midianites too. Yeah, they were.
That's a different one. There's so many.
The Midianites is the one where they took take the girls for yourself. The
slaves.
Right?
That's
in Numbers. That's in Numbers.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh gosh, the war on the Midianites. How nice. The genocide of Canaan. I love teaching little children about these scriptures.
Yeah, I was wondering this too, Johnny. Is albinism or albinism, I'm not sure how it's pronounced, heritable? If it's from two sets of recessive traits, it could skip generations.
Which is why we have albinos today. They're just recessive from Noah. Well, I think all kinds would. Oh, don't get me into kinds. Oh my gosh, me and Kelly have talked about kinds ad nauseum, haven't we?
Oh god, species, kinds, whatever the hell.
All kinds would have to have some albinism in their genetics, right?
Genome.
Oh,
to the best of my knowledge, all animals do have albinos.
If you have melanism, you have
you have melanin.
Yeah.
Well, doesn't almost, well, I guess there's jellyfish who don't. So I guess no, not everything has melanin.
Pigmentation, right? That's all that's required. So you got melanin. I think there's, what's the red one called? There's starts with a.
Oh God! See, this is terrible because I used to know all this stuff because I'm a hairstylist and I was taught all this. So it's pretty terrible that I don't remember these words.
Damn it!
I have natural. It doesn't show up when my hair grows out, but I have a natural white spot up here.
Mm. Oh yeah,
that's interesting.
I don't know if that's where me and my twin separated. I always thought maybe that's what it was, but I don't know.
Oh wow. Never know,
like a scar, right? Or maybe where my head was laying against him when we were in the womb. I don't know.
Did something to the hair follicle that it didn't produce color anymore?
Yeah, altered the genetics in that little patch right there, right?
Yeah, I love those little patches.
Yeah, I like a piebald, right? That's what it reminds me of, like a piebald snake where I have that little patch right there. Mm-hmm. It feels different too. It's like if you touch it, it's like bristly or bristlier.
Yeah, like thicker, coarse. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
Logan says, "Whoa, I'm a twin too."
Twins.
I'm a twin. I'm an identical twin. And my brother is so macho. It's so cute. He's got a big beard and wears cowboy hats and stuff like that. It's adorable. I love him so much. He's
I'm an only child. I'm always jealous.
Yeah.
I'm always jealous of people who have like brothers and sisters. Because. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh, poor me.
Yeah. Poor spoiled only child who got everything for Christmas.
Well,
I don't know.
If we celebrated Christmas, maybe. honestly, even if
JWs don't celebrate Christmas.
No.
Do they celebrate anything?
Things.
The only thing that they celebrate is like marriage and anniversaries and the memorial of Jesus' death. That's kind of like the top three things.
So you do celebrate Easter in a way. Because, well, that would be Jesus' death.
Yeah, but it's not like a soul. It's literally like a funeral. So
okay. Like what we do on Good Friday.
We would have a
service of,
right,
of
more of, serene. Yeah.
What's the point of being Christian and not celebrating Christmas? That's like the best part of it. That's the only part that I take from it. I'm like, yeah, I'll
indulge in holidays.
Easter's kind of lame, but yeah, go ahead. I'm sorry.
I was just the opposite. When I was a believer, to me, Easter was everything. Because I thought Christmas was worthless. I mean, if Jesus came and was born and that was it, he'd be worthless. And so I always considered Easter far more important because that was a celebration of the important thing that he did.
Yeah, the resurrection.
Right.
Yeah.
I agree with you. I kind of don't understand why you wouldn't want to celebrate something, but no, they don't celebrate anything.
Yeah, you should celebrate that he rose from the dead. I would think the resurrection would be, when we would have the Good Friday service to memorialize his death, you know, we always left very somber, but you came back on Easter Sunday and everybody was all saying, "He is risen. He is risen indeed." And he is risen. He is risen indeed. And, you know, it was the happiest day of the year.
Were you allowed to get emotional about the resurrection, Rion?
Like, no, not really. No, we didn't behave like that. No, it would be
That's so much. Weird. It seems like I always think of that as like a cornerstone expectation from Christianity. That like, no matter which branch you're in, right, the resurrection is something you get emotional about, something that you're emotionally tied to.
Attached to.
And that's peculiar. That way just in your family?
Oh, that breaks my heart.
Yeah.
When people are disfellowshipped and they have people considering you dead. What did you ask me? I'm sorry, Bree.
Oh, no, you're fine. You're reading the comments. It's okay. What did I ask?
Something celebrating something, did you? Multitasking.
You were originally asking if Rion was allowed to get all excited over the resurrection. Oh, yeah. If you were allowed to show emotion over...
Yeah, was it? I said, was it just your family, or was it, is that the whole religion?
Like the whole religion. No, the whole religion's pretty much like that. They're very somber. Like you don't want to be too loud, too obnoxious. You don't even want to sing too loud. Like even when you sing songs at the Kingdom Hall, you shouldn't be like overtly loud. It's so weird, bro. I'm telling you, it's just so super weird how they want people to worship. Plain. They want you plain and to be separate from the world. Oh my God. Like you have no idea. Like if you've seen, like I've literally rolled all over my damn floor. And can you imagine me sitting 2 hours at a Kingdom Hall? I used to do exercises in my seat because I didn't know what to do with myself. So I would do I would just like march in place and stuff and squeeze my butt. So I would just sit there.
Do your Kegels.
I honestly did. I'm not lying to you. I was doing them before I knew what I was doing because I guess I needed an outlet to get the energy out because I was just sat there. So it's really difficult.
How long is a JW service?
But it depends. On the Sunday, they're like around 2 hours, just shy. And then on a Thursday night, they're like an hour and a half, and Tuesday they're an hour.
And you got to remember as well that, like we talked about when I first came in, time is relative. So I think inside the Kingdom Hall, time is actually a little bit slower than outside. Right?
It goes backwards. Like when you get in there, it's like molasses.
When I said you were loud, I wasn't necessarily talking about your voice. I mean, your personality, your hair, your whole thing you've got going on here, the lights.
No, but you're right.
I love your plants, by the way. So
thank you, my babies. But you're right, though. Like generally speaking, like if I was wearing like my jewelry and had my bright purple hair and wearing bright clothes, like that wouldn't be acceptable, really.
Dan says you can't drink the wine. Is there no communion in a JW service?
The 144,000 can drink the wine.
Ah, okay.
Ah.
And how does one know if one is one of the 144,000?
Oh, come on, silly. The Holy Spirit lets you know that.
Ah, okay. So you just let the elders know that the Holy Spirit told you that, and then they're
yeah, good you just know.
Okay.
Yeah, you just, how can they question you? Like, they can't tell you you're not chosen. So if you say you're chosen,
take advantage of, though.
I honestly wonder if people have, or they're too afraid. That's either they're so just like, oh yeah, I'm chosen. Hell yeah, this is me. I feel it. I feel the Spirit. Or they're just like, well, let me see what happens.
I almost became a JW.
Oh, no. Oh God. Thank fuck you didn't.
I do. But I've told this story to very few people, but I was searching for a God. I felt sure that there was a God existed. I just had to find this God. So I started looking, and I found this tract in the shrubs in front of my house, and I read it, and I said, this makes sense. These people know who God is. Who is this? It's the Jehovah Witnesses. How do I contact them? I looked at the back of the tract. There's no address. There's no phone number. No way to contact them. So that was the end. I did not become a JW, but I would have if there had been a phone number on that tract.
Interesting. Boy, that I find that surprising that they didn't take that opportunity, because I tell you what, they would have loved to hear from you. You'd have made their night. You would have made.
I think someone came to the door and they dropped it when they were leaving, you know, because no one was home, because I just found it in the shrubs.
Right. Yeah, it probably, because they're notorious. At least they used to. We'd put them between screens and any place we could shove them, we would put them. But some people would get upset about it because it was an indication that nobody was home. So I think there were possibly people getting robbed. I don't know, but
this would have been in the mid 70s. So it probably was before those complaints.
Maybe. Yeah. Yeah. I guess that's kind of a while ago. I would hope they've gotten their stuff together since then, but can't guarantee that.
Dan says God planted it in the shrubs
just for you. It was divine intervention, didn't you?
That's right.
Oh God, yeah, the chick tracks, those things are horrifying. I got one of those from an atheist convention, and
those are what were preached to me when I became a Christian, was chick tracks. You know, the first thing I saw was the JW track, and then the second thing I saw was the chick tracks, even before I saw a Bible.
Oh, wow. And they're so hateful and twisted. Well, I never saw chick tracks until that atheist convention, but the one I saw was disgusting.
Well, I think we've done a fairly decent job on talking about time, even though we didn't go very far into the philosophy. At least we got the A and B theories, so we're a little subtle. I do have one question.
Thank you, Bri.
For you, Bri. On the A theory of time, if the theory of relativity is well supported, and the theory of relativity excludes the A theory of time and supports the B theory of time, does that not then negate the A theory of time?
Yeah. It really does. I mean, there are workarounds for the A theory of time. And time does, things that we've discovered about relativity. Again, it's relative. Relativity is relative.
It's relative.
Right?
It's all relative. So
it's well founded, but it's the same kind of arguments that people make about physics for flat Earth. It's like, can you prove gravity? Right. It's like, well, we have these experiments, but you can only check the speed of light going one direction, though, or it going back and then forth. You can't check it going one direction. It's impossible. And it's like, okay. So that's the kind of arguments you get for a theory of time. You know, that's where I'll leave it.
Hey, that's more than I've ever known. So
yeah, that was helpful. He says,
I wish to know these things.
Hugh asks, do you know about the, and I don't know how you say that,
Cthulhu?
Cthulhu.
Cthulhu. I'm not sure if I do or not.
I haven't seen that one, but I kind of want to now because I like Cthulhu.
My
the evil Cthulhu.
My friend.
Oh, then no, Lincoln, I haven't, if that's what it is.
She does Tic Trac readings on her
channel. Oh, really?
Yeah. Mm. But yeah, I haven't seen the Cthulhu one. I do like Cthulhu, and I like cosmic horror in general because I do like the idea that if there are deities and gods out there, they're going to be more like that, and they aren't going to care about us little,
yeah,
right, on this
planet. They wouldn't care.
Yeah,
I agree.
Any more than we care about the ants in the ant hill across the street, you know?
Mm-hmm.
They wouldn't. Yeah.
Anyway. Jay says there's no time to talk about the time. I don't have the time.
I don't have time to read that comment, Jay. Okay. Gosh.
What's your favorite time travel movie? Both of you go.
Oh, probably Back to the Future. I mean, come on. I'm like an 80s kid. Mm-hmm. Sorry.
I know mine's the same one.
Yeah. Oh, is it? Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's a good one.
I say I'd have to say the next same.
Yeah, for me, that was like, what? I don't know. I just thought that was like the coolest movie when I first saw it. Eternity
movies are good too, though.
Like, yeah, actually, they're really, yeah, they are good too. And that's like cult memories, like one of those cult classics, I guess you could say, mm-hmm. where you just know these like weird quotes. Like people might not even know what movie they come from, but like they know these quotes. It's, yeah.
Rion, do you have any advice for anti-theist atheist who has been trying to talk to his mother for 40, you know, who's been a JW for 40 years?
You know, it is so difficult because we have friends of mine in the audience who are PIMO, which means they're physically stuck in the religion, but they're mentally out, PIMO.
Mm.
And, you know, they have loved ones, partners, what have you, who are still in it. And like now they're in this mode of trying to move out of the religion, but they still have a partner who's in. How do they wake them up? And we talk about this all the time because I wish I had an answer. The only thing that I can think of is to ask people questions. Just start at the basics and then ask if it's biblical. Because I guarantee you most of the time it's not biblical, or if it is, it's cherry picked. So look at the context. If you can get people to do at least start questioning and doing some research, but a lot of times they don't want to do it. They're afraid.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I wish I had an answer. I truly do, but okay. That's my best shot in the dark.
Okay. My best Jehovah Witness specific, and it might not work as, yeah, well, I don't think anything would work as well with Jehovah Witness just because of the incredible mind control that they have on their people. There was some mind control where I was, you know, we weren't supposed to look at things that were against our faith unless we were doing it specifically to see why they were wrong. But there wasn't any, it wasn't forbidden. You know, nothing was forbidden. It just wasn't a good idea. But right. For me, it absolutely was history. Because looking, any other subject that you pick, science, whatever, it's easy for a person that's in a biblical mindset to say, that's not true, they got it wrong, and I know you got it wrong because of the Bible. But history is much harder to deny because you look at, like, the pyramids exist.
Right.
You can't deny the pyramids exist. You can go see them. And they existed all through the time. They were still building pyramids through the time that the alleged flood occurred. Yeah. How could they be building pyramids if the flood was occurring?
I got a fun fact about the pyramid that puts the time scale into frame. There were still woolly mammoths in Siberia when the pyramids were built.
Oh, man.
Wow.
Poor woolies. Yeah, doesn't that really kind of put it into perspective, though?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Like how long ago it was. Mm-hmm. It's amazing. But yeah, you know what you said about time. That's actually, I really want to concur with that, especially when you have a religion who's based on these different like time calculations. And when you find that one of their huge prophecies is based on the fall of a temple and they've miscalculated, they miscalculated it. So, yeah, the temple fell in what, 587, not 607. So the Jehovah's Witnesses have calculated based on this wrong date. So I agree with you. I agree. The history of Canaan is something that I'm trying to learn because it's really putting the Bible in a better perspective and context of the writings. So do it. History.
Yeah. The one that was the clincher, the one that shattered my faith was when I heard Aaron Ross say that history proves that the flood not only could not happen, but that it did not happen. Because you look at ancient history, and there is no time period when there was 100 years where the planet was devoid of people. Mm-hmm. And I knew he was right, because I'd taken enough courses in ancient history to know that there were people in China, there were people in India, there were people in South America. There's never a time when archaeologists say, okay, there's this 100-year gap where there's no humans on Earth. That never happened. You never hear that. And yet, if the flood literally happened, from the day that Noah landed until the Tower of Babel, there should be no people on the entire planet other than in Babylon, because the people didn't disperse until the Tower of Babel, and that was about 100 years later.
Yeah, the math don't math. When you really start to break it down, it doesn't, but you have to remove all of these ideas that have been put into your head by other people. Like, read the Bible without other voices.
This is a really interesting comment. Cleopatra lived closer to the moon landing than to the building of the pyramids.
Wow. Like, that's freaking weird.
Mm-hmm.
Now that's some perspective.
So like Anne Frank, MLK and Barbara Walters were all born the same year, something like that. Didn't she just die too?
Yes, she did.
Yeah. Wow. So yeah. Damn. What a shame.
Well, I'm going to go ahead and start wrapping things up at this point. Thank you very much for coming in, Bree. That it was, you know, the comments that you added were very helpful. And thank you so much for coming, Ryan. It was great to meet you. And I think, you know, even though we had a bit of a disconnect as to what your expertise was, you know, by the person who linked us up, it still was a fascinating conversation. And I was very glad to have you.
Thank you. And it was great to meet you and get to talk to you. And you too, Bree. Thank you for coming in and saving the boat before we saving the sinking boat. Now, if you ever want to talk about like gods, like I could talk about like biblical gods. You ever want to have that show, you let me know. We can go into that fantasy realm. But sorry that my idea of time coming from somebody with ADHD. Sorry.
Well, it's all relative, right? Let's keep that in scope. It's all relative.
I need that on a t-shirt, okay?
That's what I say if I'm late for work. I'm like, time's really just relative, right? It's how much you put into it, right?
Right. It's all objective to somebody, correct? Somebody out there.
And the link to Ryan's channel is in the comments. And
thank you.
So if you have not already subscribed to Ryan, please go and subscribe to Ryan. She has some really interesting content there. And Bree's link is not in the comments right now, but I will link that after the show. And I think everyone here is already subscribed to Bree, because Bree's been on here a number of times, and Bree is frequently in the chat.
Looking at the live chat, I don't know if I'm going to get any new subscribers from the new
I see you around all the time in comment sections, but I don't know that I've ever got to like talk to you face to face before, Bree. Yeah.
I'm almost 2,000 though. So if you don't have anybody who subscribe, or any channels that are subscribed to me, all you people out there, if you got a little sock channel, go ahead and just give me a sub so I can get that 1K and get that over with.
I know. It's so hard to hit these stupid little plateau levels they want you to.
Mm-hmm. I have double the watch time that I need. I got 8,000 watch hours of the 4,000 that I needed. So.
Oh, damn.
You know what you really need, Bree? You need to do a collab with either Polygia or Vice Rhino.
Yeah.
That's what did it for me. As soon as I did a collab with Vice Rhino, my numbers doubled immediately.
That's what happened with AJ.
Oh, that's too. Awesome.
Hooked up with Polygia and did that Hoven thing. But that was a big deal, that stuff. All it the was. Stuff that they released and covered in that video. I
love Polygia.
Yeah. McKinnon Mitchell did a great take on that situation too, if you hadn't seen that documentary film about it.
I followed you.
Johnny, you? I don't remember. My memory is not what it used to be. I'm trying to remember if I'm subscribed to Johnny and if I've seen Johnny, and I've watched so many new people in the last 4 months that I just can't even remember anymore. It's funny because my memory was my best quality when I was young. But after I turned 50, it just isn't what it used to be.
I blame the weed. So,
well, I can't do that because I never had weed. I never tried weed until a year ago.
Yeah,
me too. It's a good excuse now. I don't know that it's to blame, but I'm going to blame it. Or trauma from religion. I kind of think that it's religious trauma along with some other stuff, but weed is fine. Weed is fine. It covers it. Less traumatic for other people to hear the story.
Okay, Johnny says I haven't put anything in them out in at least 4 months. Okay, then I probably am not subscribed to you, Johnny. I probably should go do that. Okay.
I just subscribe to John.
Okay.
I subscribe to anybody who makes content, so I'll find you, Johnny.
Johnny Rapine.
I've had Johnny in here once before. I should bring Johnny back and do a show to try to get him some more subscribers. That should work because he's a fun person to talk to. Okay. With that, let's go ahead and wrap up. Thank you so much for coming. It has been a wonderful topic. Is there anything that you would like to talk about that's coming up on your show, Ryan?
Oh gosh, for my channel specifically, no, not necessarily. I'm always just putting out whatever the hell I decide to put out. I do have other channels that I collaborate with, Apostate Coalition. That's where I do stuff with other high control members. We're trying to get like a collaboration of a bunch of different high control members to make videos and educational kind of stuff for awareness and hopefully some activism stuff. I do a little morning segment called Apostate Weekly. If you look up Apostate Weekly, we just started that. And I'm also on Skeptic Haven. So I host on Skeptic Haven, if you've heard of that channel. Okay. So yeah, there's my plugs. There's where you can find me. Oh, or TikTok, but most people know me from my TikTok, okay. A Sandwich. And that's that. Sorry, y'all. All my plugs, plug.
Okay. And Bree, what do you have coming up?
Well, in the next few or the next couple of weeks, I don't know. I don't have the day yet. Still working on the scripting here for him right now, but I got a thing that I'm doing with R and Raw.
Oh, cool.
A new series.
Oh, excuse me. That's awesome. Sorry. Yeah. That's really cool.
I've got it over here in this panel working on it right now. He's in there working on it too, but it's going to be, it's gonna be pretty fun. If you saw the snake series that he did, it's gonna be something similar to that. But you'll have to wait and see what it's about, so I don't get to spill the beans. But the fact that he has me as his research assistant on it might give a hint about what it's about, maybe.
Mm-hmm. Nice. Something about bugs.
Other than that, I got my weekly show, Live from the Hive. It's on Saturday at 9:30 a.m. I have, we're going to be looking at some hyenas that were allegedly shot in North America and stuff like that. Really weird stuff on Cryptic Corner. And I'm going to blow it wide open. But please join us. I'm also probably going to, I think I got something. I guess Hoven the Younger that I have on the on the floor for a discussion.
Oh, Hoven. Sure.
Eric Hoven. Yeah.
Eric Hoven.
Okay.
Anyway, that's what I got going on immediately in the immediate future. So, but other stuff in the works.
Very good. And coming up on my channel next week, that my guest will be Kyle Brewer, Cosmic Kyle. And I don't have a specific topic, but we will be talking about astronomy. And then my scripted video this week, I am responding to someone who did the Ray Comfort script to an AI. Someone tried to convert a
robot. I can't wait to see that. I can't wait for that. That's this week. I got to see that.
Yeah, that's week. That will come out on Saturday.
Have you ever told a lie?
Friday for my channel members and patrons. Saturday for the public. I'm sorry, what'd you say?
So we asked the have you ever told a lie thing to them?
Yeah. He went through the whole script with an AI.
Mm-hmm. Oh, God. I can't wait.
Okay. Thank you, everyone, for coming.
Thank you so much.
Thank you
for having me.
Live your life.
Good night.
Bye.